All right, so that brings us to the serious part of the day. We've got Tom Saggers. Come forward, Tom. Tom has been mixed up in quite a number of things. He was the publisher of my book. He was mixed up in the silver game at one stage. He's mixed up in vintage cars and has a business which imports vintage tyres for vintage cars. He's got five Daimlers. He's got a 1909 Derrick. And another one, what's the other?
26 Rover.
A 26 Rover, and another one? Isn't there
another
one?
A 29 Oakland.
A 29 Oakland, it goes on and on.
54 International.
54 International, yes.
That's so checked.
When he's not fixing cars, he's asleep. Throughout his life, he's taken an interest not only in cars, but in aviation. And he's taken a particular interest in the life of Dr. F.W. Lanchester, who most people don't know anything about. But I remember, as a young bloke, being told by my father that a car had an automatic gear shift, where you moved it into the gear and later, at your leisure, stabbed the clutch and it changed gears for you. The bus company that ran past our place bought a bus with this involved in it, and I was intrigued. I was only probably 10, 12 years old, but I couldn't understand the mechanics of what Dr. Lanchester had produced in the way of a gearbox. You find a similar sort of mechanism on the same thing is used in Formula One racing cars these days. But to tell you more about Mr. Lanchester, Dr. Lanchester, and his aviation inventions in particular, Tom Saggers.
Ladies and gentlemen, can you all hear me?
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, Frederick William Lanchester, philosopher, engineer, mathematician, musician, author, and poet, just to name a few of his accomplishments. This is Dr. Fred. He was actually an absolutely brilliant person. And this is his family tree. His father, Henry Jones, who is, where is this one?
Red one.
The red one. Henry Jones here, was an architect, a surveyor, and a town planner. He, Henry Jones, married Octavia Ward, and she was the eighth child in her family. Her grandfather, Mr. Marlowe, was a silversmith. Henry Jones' father, Frederick, was a ship owner, and his mother was the daughter of a map publisher. Octavia, Frederick's mother, was also a brilliant person. She was considerable intelligence. She taught Latin and mathematics. As you can see, there were eight siblings in Frederick's family. Frederick William became an engineer. Henry Vaughan was an architect like his father. Francis Charles went into business and banking and actually became the financial manager of Lanchester Motor Cars. Edward Norman became a sign writer and artist. He was actually buried in Albany, and his family live in Lesmurdy, or his descendants live in Lesmurdy. George Herbert also became an engineer, and he joined his brother Frederick in the Lanchester motor car business. Of the three sisters, I haven't done a lot of research, but since I wrote this, I've come across a little bit about them. One of them, or two of them, became artists. Frederick's first school days, at the age of six, he went to a kindergarten, and he acquired an appetite for knowledge. This was encouraged by his school teacher, Miss Osman. After 4 years, he was sent to Oxford House, a preparatory boarding school in Brighton. Here he found science and mathematics to be easy to understand and excelled in both fields. At the age of 16, he went to Southampton to study at the Hartley Institution, and after 2 years of study of science and engineering, won a scholarship to attend the Normal School of Science at South Kensington. In 1885, when not quite 17 years old, he went to the National School of Science and the Royal School of Mines. As well as attending the School of Mines, he enrolled for evening lectures at the Finsbury Technical College, and it was here he gained extensive knowledge and invaluable workshop experience. It was whilst studying that he made his patented his first two inventions. This is a pendulum accelerometer for gas engines. His first job, after leaving the schools, he joined the Forward Gas Engine Company, and within 2 years he was acting as foreman. He also invented a radial cursor to be used with the slide rule. In 1888, at the age of 20, he took on contract drafting for patent applications, and from 1889 to 1891 he worked for the Gas Engine Company, where he invented several improvements to gas engine technology and was made foreman. It was whilst on a trip to America to sell his patents that he became interested in aerial flight. And after studying all available engines, he decided that none was available in the early days of the 10th decade of the 19th century were suitable for propulsion of a man-made flying machine. He then went into developing his first motor car to try and develop an engine that would be smooth to put into aircraft. This was the first Lanchester motor car of 1895. It is the first four-wheeled, petrol-driven car designed and built in England. And it is recognised that there were other cars that were assembled from European components, but this is the first four-wheeled, petrol-driven car to be built in England and designed there. That engine was unsatisfactory on that car, so he developed another engine, a twin cylinder, which has two crankshafts, one, two, and twin cylinders, and it has six connecting rods. Each cylinder is connected to one crankshaft with one connecting rod and two to the other one, so that they actually inter-rotate. And it proved to be quite successful, and it was vibrationless. That was the twin cylinder Lanchester design. From that, it went into this car, the 1900 Lanchester, and that went into production in 1900 and 1901. He also became very interested in flight very early on. In 1891, he was experimenting with all different forms of gliders. As you can see, he's all different shapes and studying the dihedral from them. And it's interesting that this one is exactly what we're using nowadays with its upturned wingtips. And he was proposing that in 1891. This is a photograph of Dr. Fred in 1894 with a self-propelled model, with a big rubber band, and it flew quite successfully. We'll move on to this one. There's another one of his gliders, once again with the upturned wingtips, and it also flew for quite a distance quite successfully. It was purely trying out all these different concepts for flying. In 1910, he published a book entitled Aerodynamics. Now, encased in here is all the theory of flight. Everything you want to know about flying is in here, all the theory. And incidentally, if you can find one of these, you'll pay $1,000 for it without any trouble. It's fascinating reading some of it, although a lot of it goes right across the top of my head. In 1911, he went into aerodynamics, which I'd never heard of until I read this, or read some of it. Once again, published in 1911, I was asked by a university to donate these two to their library, but I declined. They're mine. Once again, $1,000 plus for that book. Good one. Back here. Where I put it. Yeah. Right. He followed those productions, those books, with another one in 1914 called Aircraft in War, The Theory of Using Aircraft for Warfare. And then later on, he published Relativity, but that was back into the 30s. I'll come to that one later. In 1911, oh, there's another one of his gliders, one of his theories. Contra rotating propellers within a frame at the back of the aircraft to push it along. That was in 1914, 1915, he was proposing these. His love of, you know, all the different things he got involved in, aircraft and aeronautics, were his main love of life. In 1911, he collaborated with Mrs. White and Thompson to build an aircraft, but unfortunately, as you can see, the undercarriage collapsed on takeoff and it didn't get off the ground.
Not a very good surface.
Not a very good surface, no. The title of Doctor was an honorary title and was bestowed upon him by the University of Birmingham. That's a sort of a brief rundown of what he was, some of his accomplishments. We've got some of his contributions to autos and aeroplanes. He had a yacht. Now, where's the yacht?
Down the end.
Down the end. As you can see, these are other accomplishments. He got involved in the patenting machine gun, shooting through propeller blades in 1919. And this one, he was very intrigued by radial and rotating engines, rotating cylinder engines. This was his second boat. He was also a very keen sailor. And this one was called Troubadour. And he applied the theory of his aeronautics and aerodynamics to his sailing, and it proved very, very successful for him in boat races. In 1942, just before Christmas, was when he published Relativity. From the front cover to the back of it, it goes, whoosh. I don't understand a word of it. It's just beyond my ken, completely. It's just an object on my library shelf. In 1941, due to several bad investments, he was unfortunately living in penury. And the Society of Motor Manufacturers and Traders organised a small annuity for him. And he died on March the 8th, 1946, at the age of 78. To wind up today, I haven't been able to give him his just dues, really. I would like to read to you a tribute that was written by Sir Henry Ricardo for the Royal Society. In Lanchester, we had one of the very rare combinations of a great scientist, a great engineer, a mathematician, an inventor, and a true artist in mechanical design. He was a man, too, of remarkable versatility, for his interests and his inventions reigned over a very wide field, including musical instruments, he was a great lover of music, and all forms of sound reproduction. He was also a poet and a philosopher. His mind worked so quickly and so directly through the intermediate stages of thought that few could keep pace with it, and this rendered him rather intolerant of their slower processes. For this reason, he was a difficult man to help, and nearly all work he achieved single-handedly. Whatever problem he tackled always from first principles, for he refused to be influenced by fashion or by the beliefs of others, unless they accorded with his own experience or common sense. He had a very fine sense of humour, which sometimes he employed a little mercilessly, for he could not tolerate the superficial or the second rate. If a subject interested him, and his interests were wide indeed, he would go into it in the minutest detail and quickly become a master of it. If it did not interest him, he would leave it severely alone, or he would not tolerate dabbling. Like all great inventors who invented ahead of their time, Lanchester had to endure the mortification of seeing his own inventions reappear years later, perhaps in slightly modified form and under another name. This he took very hardly, for he failed to recognise and accept that this, inevitably, is the fate of all such. It is well nigh impossible to present at present to access clearly the influence of his work on the road and in the air, on the life of man, or on the society in which we live. Certainly it was great and decisive, and clearly people lived differently because of it. Lanchester shared the lot of most men of genius in not receiving full recognition during his lifetime. It might have been a consolation to him to know that the University of Southampton would have a Lanchester House, a College of Aeronautics at Lanchester Hall, Coventry, a Lanchester College of Technology, and the Royal Aeronautical Society, a day each year on which to remember him. Ladies and gentlemen, Frederick William Lanchester. Thank you.